What's up, Super Nintendos? Welcome to the Nintendo Voice Chat Podcast, the only Nintendo podcast recommended by 7 out of 10 dentists. I am your host, Seth Macy, joined today by Reb Valentine.
What's going on, Seth Macy?
Jada Griffin.
Hello. These horns probably will not make it through the whole show.
Oh, well, show's over, folks. Sorry, Jeffrey, but we're also joined by Jeffrey Vega.
It's-a me, Jeffrey.
Oh, that's funny that you would say it like that, because guess what today's topic is? We're going to be talking about the Mario movie. I've seen the Mario movie. Reb, you seen the Mario movie?
I saw the Mario movie last night.
Jay, did you see the Mario movie?
I liked it. It was so nice, I saw it twice.
Wow, that's impressive. Jeffrey, did you see the... I know you did. You were on the red carpet.
I actually have also seen it twice, and I was really excited to one-up Jada, and I...
you know what? I'm done. No, I'm leaving this podcast.
No,
I can't deal with it.
No, we can't do that.
I can't deal with it.
We have to just all labor on, and we're going to talk about. Listen, by the way, folks who are listening at home, and you're like, well, I'm not listening to this podcast because they're going to spoil the Super Mario movie for me. No, we're not. We're going to give our impressions spoiler free. And if we do spoil something, like how Mario dies at the end.
Oh, sad.
I mean, if it didn't have that, would it be a Mario movie?
Yeah.
Like, come on. Everybody's fallen in a hole in Super Mario.
Yeah. I mean, exactly. Zelda falls in a hole in Tears of the Kingdom. Everyone's fallen into holes this year.
Yep.
Zelda. Zelda also doesn't die in the Mario movie, but neither does Super Mario. So that wasn't a real spoiler.
But it was cool when she appeared.
It was really cool when Zelda was just like there for no reason. She
needed
a sandwich. It was so odd. That's also not true. We're not spoiling this. We are going to do our best. However, I know that the definition of a spoiler has over the last decade or so stretched to include like mentioning the name of the movie is a spoiler now.
Did you all know that Mario is in this movie?
Reb!
Look, I don't want to spoil it or anything, but he does get super Mario.
Oh my goodness.
And he has a brother.
Oh,
anyway,
you all may as well just not see the movie at all at this point.
Yeah, don't see it.
Don't bother.
We've already told everything there is to see.
You've got the plot, basically.
Just sit at home and eat popcorn in the dark by yourself. Well, what I would like to invite the panel to do, and because I'm going to start off once again, I have taken notes and I've written them in cursive, and I am going to rate my personal rating. The Super Mario Brothers movie. Now, the IGN review, which was by Tom Jorgensen, gave it an 8, which on the scale is great. A little mnemonic there to help you remember 8 rhymes with great. So I am my personal score for the Super Mario Brothers movie, and you're welcome to tell me that I'm wrong. My opinion is wrong. I gave it a 7, which is good, on the IGN scale. The voice cast overall, I want to give it an 8. Jack Black as Bowser, 11 out of 10.
Oh,
Jack
my
Black
God. Yes.
Is the best part of this movie. Visuals, 10. It was like one of the most beautiful movies, animated movies I think I've ever seen. And I think seeing it on the big screen, I would recommend that because it is just, it's so enormous and colorful and beautiful and so detailed. So visuals, 10. Set pieces, action sequences, 10 again. There's some really cool, exciting, fun stuff happening on the screen. It's never too hard to follow along with. It's a frenetic pace that just can't be stopped. I mean, until it does, obviously. There is like a 90-minute runtime. Oh, spoiler. References and Easter eggs, 11 out of 10. I was sometimes distracted trying to be like, wait a minute, is that what I think it is? And keep your eyes peeled, Nintendo fans. You're going to be really pleased by just the cool reference. And they're not overt and like they don't bang you over the head and say, like, remember this. It's just like subtle, not even subtle. No, it's just
a lot of it is subtle.
There's a lot of subtle ones.
It's both.
It's both. Yeah, sure. As far as the story, I'm going to give that a 4 because I thought it was very weak and as far as a story goes, I thought it was kind of bad. And for the message of the movie, I'm going to also give that a 4 because I thought it was pretty trite and cliche. So overall,
how would you compare it to the first Super Mario game story?
To the Mario game story? I would say that the story of the game Super Mario Brothers for the NES is better than the movie because it the story for the movie felt like it was being written while the movie was going, if that makes any sense.
Okay.
So but that being said, I had a very good time. I enjoyed it a lot. I have some other notes here. I will probably be okay if I don't see it twice, like Jada and Jeffrey, like the Jays.
Wow, fake fan.
Yep.
Yeah.
Not a Mario fan.
I'm revising my prediction. I don't think this is going to be the biggest animated movie of all time. I know I've been saying that for months.
Wow. Next thing you know, he's going to be saying that Tears of the Kingdom isn't a 10 out of 10.
No, that's an 11 out of 4. That is going to be the greatest game ever made by human hands.
Why is the maximum lowered?
Every other game is now reduced to a 4 just because because Tears of the Kingdom.
4 is the high on the Tears of the Kingdom scale. 4 is the highest that it can be. And so 11 actually breaks a lot of laws of physics.
Okay. We're going to have to rewrite the review scale now.
Not at all.
4 is the highest. So if it's an 11, that means it's almost 3 times the maximum.
This is like the movie theater security, like dragging Seth out of the theater.
No, I think that just, 4 just sounds better than...
Look, okay. We're not talking about Tears of the Kingdom. I have notes. I wrote it in cursive. So there are, it's a three act structure, which is like, okay, it's fine. Like it's a common, very easy to put together, but it was jarring. Like you knew exactly, I almost expected there was going to be like a title card, like now our heroes must overcome adversity for like act two. So yeah, I thought structurally and story-wise, it was not great, but for like fun and visuals and like the kids in the theater, we're having the best time. Like they're clapping when I almost spoiled some stuff, but they were just having so much fun. And I recognize that this is a kids movie, which is what everyone's going to say. Oh, this kids movie shouldn't have a story. To which I say, well, have you seen a movie called WALL-E? Have you seen a movie called Watership Down, which actually is
a
kids movie?
Oh my God, Seth.
Yeah, no, not at all. No, I was just joking about that. But like Never Ending Story.
Robin Hood.
Well, you were comparing it to The Lion King, which I think the weird CG Lion King was an absolute abomination. But Lion King has one of the best animated movie plots.
Shakespearean.
Yeah, I mean, it is. It's basically Shakespeare for kids, which, turns out when you put lions in it, pretty good.
Yep. I love the last time actually I was in the city, I saw the all lion. Hamlet, and it was amazing. The Two Gentlemen of Verona. I've never seen that until you've seen it with lions. I'm just saying, pardon? Shakespeare plays. All right, that is my overall 7 story problems, but it's still a super fun time. Everyone should see it. It will leave a smile on your face. Go and also enjoy popcorn. I'm still like doing that thing. When you floss like after the theater, you're like, how did that get down in there?
Yeah. Seth, you saw that movie like 4 months ago.
I know, and I've been flossing religiously ever since.
Your 5 or 6 approves.
Times a day. Actually, it turns out it's just a tooth. I thought it was a kernel of pop. But anyway, hey Reb, how do you feel about the Super Mario Brothers movie? No spoilers.
I'm not gonna go through and score everything like you did because I.
Why do I even try?
Because I basically agree with every score you just gave it.
Awesome.
I might tweak a couple here or there, but that's pretty much how I feel. I feel like the voice cast largely did a really good job. Honestly, Chris Pratt was fine.
Yeah.
Like aggressively
nobody
fine.
Did a bad job.
Whatever. I was not thinking about Chris Pratt being Mario after the first 2 seconds of the movie. It just went out of my head. Jack Black.
He's so cool.
Chewed the scenery at every possible moment. I thought Charlie Day did a really good job.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I wish I could have seen more of him.
Oh, yeah, definitely. We needed way more Charlie Day.
Yeah, it's not that there was like a low amount of Luigi in the movie, but I could have taken some more.
Yes.
Yeah.
I thought the score was phenomenal.
The score was the best part of the movie.
It is. If you're a Mario music nerd, like you're gonna get so into this. I like you, Seth, I've only seen it once. I think I probably won't go out of my way to see it again. Like if someone throws it on the TV, I'll watch it. But like I probably won't go out of my way to see it again. But I would if I could like just cut out all of the voices and just like focus on the score. Just because there's a lot of like really good musical Easter eggs. I don't want to I'm not going to spoil anything for people, but there was a specific moment kind of in the first half of the movie where there's a scene happening to a character I really liked, and you get two bars of a really recognizable theme from a very specific game in the Mario universe. And I was like, ah, it's that game. Yep. And then it was gone and it was over and it moved on. And I was like, oh, I could have taken more of that. But like, also I was just so happy. It got like, it got just this little nod in there. Yeah. It's like really cute. Yeah. Music's great. Lovely to look at. But yeah, it's just very frantic. It feels like at the start of that movie, someone just grabs Mario by the hand and just yanks him through a plot as fast as possible.
That's exactly. You just spoiled the plot. They actually just yank him around. The whole
and that I person mean, is of, Princess Peach.
Like he's,
pretty much.
It's just, and that's kind of part of it. But there's a lot of moments of being very careful here of somebody just sort of showing up and then being like, oh, well now we have to go do this. And there's never like any explanation as to why that's the thing to do now or how any of these people know that that's the thing they're supposed to be doing or how anybody feels about it. Also, that's probably fine. Like, look, I got everything I wanted out of this. It was really fun. I had a great time. I was at a later showing, so there weren't any kids there, but I know multiple of my friends who have young kids who have told me weirdly specific language across multiple people that their kids just grinned through the whole movie, like just smiled this huge smile.
That's what my mom and dad said about me, actually, because I did.
Yeah, well, I kind of did too. I mean, I think it's going to be great for Nintendo fans. Like, if you're there to just pick apart references and just to see Mario on the big screen, you're going to have a wonderful time. If you've got kids, they're going to have a wonderful time. If I would like maybe say, don't bring like adults who don't know what Mario is. Like,
yeah,
if you have
because
like a
they
partner
don't exist.
Or a parent.
No, we thought that about the person who didn't ever play Tetris. Don't bring the person who never played Tetris to this movie.
No, don't. Like, don't bring like a parent or a partner who is just really not into this stuff because they're gonna be kind of like, what was this?
Yep.
But apart from that, like, go and have a good time. It was a blast. I enjoyed it. Jack Black having a great time.
So good. He's so
can't stop thinking about him.
I know. He's like can he win an Oscar for this? Only time will tell. Is it too soon to whisper Oscar?
We should. We should all start whispering Oscar.
But
no.
Jada, what are you I would love to hear your thoughts.
Yeah.
Since you are in the 2X club.
Yeah. I the first time watching it through, I was kind of like just enjoying it for what it was. The second time I went through and kind of like, I was like looking for deeper Easter eggs and stuff. And, you know, the 11 out of 10 Easter eggs, 100% true. I might even bump it up to like a 14 out of like 8.
Oh my God.
Just right.
What are these fractions?
There's so many.
The envelope.
There's so many like Easter eggs. And like, I caught so many on my second way through that I missed on the first way through. And so like, for me, it was worth watching it a second time because I love seeing Easter eggs in my movies like that. The score, again, that's like a 22 out of 5. Like,
Hamilton is somewhere like
video game music score.
His world is breaking because of what you were doing to a scoring system.
The musical score is like by far the best part of this movie, hands down. The original song from Jack Black that's in the movie is just amazing, and I have not left. Singing that, so I have not left the theater without singing that song on repeat to myself. I have been listening to Tenacious D on repeat on Spotify because that's how much I love Jack Black's performance. I'm wearing the horns in the honor because Bowser is by far the best character of this movie, and we
100%.
We need a second movie that is just Bowser, Peach, and Luigi. That's all we need in the sequel. We need to do Mario is missing. For the second movie, and we can just, you know, sideline Crisp Rat and, you know, Mario and all that stuff and bring him back in at the end. That's fine.
Yeah.
But yeah, overall, like you guys said, story is, it's a very much a nothing burger. It's just kind of, it's there. It gets you from point A to point B without explaining anything. And you know what? It's okay for that. In that first screening I went to, there were kids in it and they were cheering and shouting and having a good time.
Like, don't have patience for plot.
It doesn't need a plot. You know, it's like I asked Seth, like, how do you compare it to the first Mario Brothers games storyline? Like, go save the princess. Like, that's go find Bowser and save the princess. That's kind of, you know, it's basically along those lines. I think it's a fantastic movie. I really enjoyed it. I agree with your 7, Seth. I think this is like a great foundation for Nintendo and their Mario movies or Nintendo franchise of movies, and I think it's only going to get better because I think we're going to get deeper in plots and more, even more Easter eggs, better musical scores, and even stuff like that. Like, I don't know how we get better musical score than we got this time, but I feel like there's so much more room to grow.
Plenty more untapped Mario.
There are so many untapped. Yeah. So, but yes.
Such iconic.
100% music. Agree.
Okay. All right. Jeffrey, as the other member of the 2X Club, who's seen it twice, I'd love to hear your
opinions. He fell asleep in his first one.
Oh my God, is that true?
That's actually not true because
red carpet.
Yeah, Jada, the first time I saw it with Jack Black. So I sat in his lap and we watched it at the premiere.
I mean, I bet it was really comfy.
Oh yeah.
It was.
Did he serenade you?
Rub your head.
Yeah, it was like surround sound. Yeah. I can't stress enough. I agree that the best part of the movie is the score. Like Brian Tyler, the composer, like working with Koji Kondo's, you know, the original Nintendo kind of, you know, composer of all those songs. They made something so beautiful. And when Reb was talking about like, oh, there's like this kind of two bars of things, I'm wondering which one you're talking about because there's
exactly
so many
talking about. But yes, there were a bunch.
And they're very quick. Like they're just like, it's just a beat and it's so wonderful. So yes, I love the movie. I think I would give it an 8 as well for great, okay, because it's weird when we talk about that this is a kids movie, because we have to remember that one of the greatest movies of all time is Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, which is a PG movie for kids. And that has one of the best stories of all time.
Yep.
So, you know, you can't really give this movie a pass. At the same time, what do I go to see this movie for? It's to see an animated Mario movie, an animated Nintendo film. Like, it's beautiful. The animation is beautiful. I was like, the whole way through, I kept thinking, oh my God, I can't believe there's a Mario movie. There's a Nintendo movie. Like, this is real. Like, this is so beautiful. And yeah, the games don't have plots, really. We don't play for the plots, but it is such a fun ride. It's like, yeah, Mario needs to go save somebody from Bowser. Like, that's it.
You can really tell the animators had a lot of fun with this film. There's so many great animations.
Yeah. And that's actually one of the things I can't get over the movie, which when everyone sees this movie, you will agree with me. Everyone's going to scroll back to the podcast and listen to this part, is that the way that they made this movie, it felt, they put so much into it. It seemed as if that this was the only time they would ever get to make a Mario movie. It's just so, they're just like, oh my God, we're never going to get another chance. Let's put every possible thing ever, which is not a bad thing at all. But the movie is 90 minutes, a tight 90, and it goes by so fast that there are a few emotional beats with certain characters. And I wish that it's just like, oh my God, like I can almost feel like a tear coming on. And then the movie's like, all right, let's keep going. Mario Kart time. Yep. And it's just like, whoa, whoa, whoa. I want to see this Mario and Luigi like brotherly love, because that is a really great part of the movie.
Yeah.
And I just like, spoiler, Mario and Luigi are brothers. I think Seth already spoiled that already. So I'm not the villain here.
Just killing me.
People could have skipped the intro.
I want someone in the comments to just put the timestamp so it starts here. It's so fun. I probably will see it again because I just love movies and any excuse to go. I will say you guys mostly work on games, I mostly work on entertainment at IGN, and I see a lot of movies multiple times, and there are so many things that I caught in the second time because there are so many Easter eggs, as Seth alluded to. I don't even know if it's a spoiler. I'm not going to say what the Easter eggs are, but like, you know, there are like other Nintendo games in the movie. That's just such a fun, some of them are very like, oh, this is a scene. And some of them are like, oh, wait, what's that on top of the TV? You know?
Yeah.
What does that sign say?
It's going to be great for like home viewing when you can pause and be like, oh, wait, what was that?
Yeah, no, I can't wait to break it down and dissect it scene by scene.
Well, if you go to Amazon.com right now for IGN Deals, you can pre-order the 4K Super Mario Brothers movie.
Whoa.
IGN Deals on Twitter.
I don't have any space on my my DVD rack or Blu-ray rack anymore.
Whoa, you're not getting the Mario movie, Jada?
I'm going to download it. I'll just do digital.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay. All right. You don't have any space on your computer.
There's another solution. Get a new DVD rack.
I just bought a new one. It's already full.
Does IGN Deals post deals on racks by chance?
Yeah, you gotta go to IGN Racks at IGN Racks on Twitter.
No.
Yeah, we can't.
God, no. Yes, please.
All right, Red. Okay, fine. Anyway, IGN shelves. Whatever.
I forgot. Bringing it back to the Mario movie for a second. I forgot I had one other rating, and I want to go on its realistic depiction of plumbing. It gets a 0 out of 10. As someone who was employed as a plumber, none of that was accurate. Other than
not
the
even the white gloves,
especially not the white. So yeah, all right, cool. So we're all in agreement. It's a great or good movie, and everyone should see it, and or maybe see it twice or even three times. I'm curious.
Take
to see
your kids.
Yes,
take, if you have kids, take them. Please take them.
Just grab a kid off the street. Hey, you're
don't,
coming.
No.
Every week now we're endorsing things you should not be doing.
I don't think things through. I thought it would be a nice gesture. Hey, kid, why don't you jump in my car? We're going to go see the Mario movie. That's probably not. Don't
canceled.
Do that.
We're getting canceled. NVC is dead.
Every single
the last
week,
episode
Dana.
Of NVC
Stranger
ever.
Danger.
I do love the idea that Seth accidentally says creepy things, but they are very wholesome. Like, I do want people to see the Mario movie. So, like, let me buy you a ticket and let's watch the movie. And yeah,
maybe just buy a ticket and give it to the kid. Like, if you're gonna do that, Seth, don't take them with you. Just like, hey, I bought a bunch of Mario movie tickets, here you go.
No,
go ask your parent. Yeah.
Just
well, I don't know.
I leave other kids alone.
Yes, that's okay, the safest yeah. thing.
Can I say really quick though that sure. after I saw the movie at the premiere, brag, and then also wow. I paid for it at the theaters to mm-hmm. to give my money.
Wow,
to
Richie, okay.
Sheesh.
Okay, I have the AMC A-list, so I don't know if I can.
So does Jada. The concessions right. line was 30 Ooh, minutes yeah. long.
I got 35.
It's great. It's a great deal.
My partner
we should
missed
post...
the opening scene.
Oh, no. Yeah. I mean, it's, I will say, oh, I forgot what I was going to say about the movie. About
hey!
The.
Yay!
No.
Yay!
No. Wait, no. Is there... Oh, I remember now. Worry not. Ninfrendos, I remembered exactly what it was, is that as soon as I got home,
you gotta cut
I
the
played
break,
Mario
right,
Kart.
Seth?
No. I played Mario Kart. It was like the, it was like this urge. I was like, oh, I really want to play Super Mario Odyssey.
Yeah.
I really want to play Mario Kart 8 yeah. Deluxe, a game originally released in 2014. I really, really, really want to play Mario games right now. Like, it was just so pretty. It was like, oh, you know what? I'm gonna bust open my copy of 3D All-Stars and we're gonna play Super Mario Sunshine in HD because the Mario wow. movie was a commercial for Mario games.
Yep.
So
yeah, I think I wanted to play Super Mario World. I think that was the one I wanted to go back and play.
So I have a weird, embarrassing confession. So I didn't want to play Mario games when I left. I can't, I'm not going to spoil this for people. We know Jack Black has a musical number. And in that musical number, he repeatedly says a specific word that is related to food in some way.
Do not look at my Twitter if you don't want to be spoiled.
All I wanted to do was eat that food when I got home.
Oh, I believe it.
I was so hungry for that very specific food item. And I didn't realize what was happening because I wanted something when I got home. And I was like, man, I really want this, but we don't have any in the house. And
it's very rare for people to keep fire flowers in the house.
Right? I know. And my partner said, is this because Jack Black sang that song? And I'm like, oh my God, that's exactly what happened. So that was what I brought home from the Mario movie.
Yeah. That's a great, that's like kind of like the menu, with Anya Taylor-Joy, who's Princess Peach. And I, after that movie, I wanted to see a cheeseburger and then eat it. Cause there's a very good cheeseburger in the movie.
I'm going to tell you a little secret. Eat a cheeseburger blindfolded, heightens all your other senses. So,
oh yeah. I want to do one of those
Ooh,
dining in the dark.
I haven't done that
sometime.
Yet.
I think that would be
Whoa.
A good idea.
I've never heard of that ever.
Oh yeah, there's dining like these the dark, fancy yeah. like dining in the dark experiences you can do where you get like this like 3 or 5 course meal or whatever. It's like expensive, whatever, but like it's completely dark.
Nope.
And you go in and More's they unlucky. Serve you and you have to eat it in the dark. And yeah.
Whoa. Wait, how do you know that it's there when they serve it?
I mean,
they have people with night vision goggles that are putting it in your mouth for you.
No.
Fisher is there delivering your dish.
Upside down.
You know where your fork and your spoon are and you know where the plate is and you just have to kind of figure it out. But yeah, it's supposedly supposed to heighten flavor or whatever. This is related to Mario in no way whatsoever.
This is related to Mario because Mario eats a cheeseburger blindfolded in the movie. Spoilers again. Oh, I can't
stop.
And it
has mushrooms on it.
Okay. Mario, well, yeah. We all agree. Mario movie. Very fun. Go see it. So now, Reb, you have a deep philosophical question for us.
Yes. So in the Mario movie, I apologize to anyone who for some reason thinks this is a spoiler.
It's probably not.
In the Mario movie, at a certain point, there is, in the movie universe, a Nintendo Entertainment System that we see.
I wouldn't call that a spoiler. I think it's just like when you play a Pokemon game and you have like the consoles in your house, like when you start, sure. Mentioning there's a console.
The context of it being there doesn't matter, but we know that the Nintendo Entertainment System exists in the universe of this movie. I want to ask you all how this happened, because in the real world, the Nintendo Entertainment System has Mario games on it. So is this a universe where Miyamoto also, does Miyamoto exist in the Mario universe? Is he creating games, or is this a universe without Miyamoto? Because we don't have, because I assume in this universe, because Mario is a real person, there are no Mario games. That wouldn't make any sense. And otherwise, Mario is playing a game about himself.
I think this is a universe where Miyamoto is making games, but he's making games about like banking and finance and other stuff like that. Yeah. It's not, he didn't have
job simulator.
Yeah, exactly. He's making those line of games. He, you know, something just didn't happen. It didn't spark his entertainment joy growing up. And, you know, he went to school for finance and stuff like that. And then that's what he made games about, because it was the new cool thing.
It's like an alternate universe Nintendo. Like, I want to know in the year that movie takes place, like what are the games they're getting now? Like does Nintendo still make a Nintendo Switch, or do they make something totally different because they've gone down like this diverging path and they don't have Mario as their mascot? Did Nintendo die without Mario? We don't know.
Oh, actually no, because this is an alternate universe where they were able to get the Popeye license and they made a Popeye game.
Popeye has become
so
the Mario.
Popeye, and in that, in the Mario movie universe, everyone is going to see the Popeye animated movie right now, and they're and on Popeye voice chat they're talking about, man, Jack Black sure was good as Bluto. Man, that was the role he was meant to play.
Anya Taylor-Joy, you know, is olive oil.
Yes. Oh, that is a great cast.
Actually, not
scene.
A bad casting.
Yeah, that's really good. It's so funny that you mentioned it's like a meta going to the movies, because I interviewed the directors, and the co-directors of the Mario movie also co-directed Teen Titans Go to the Movies.
I love Teen Titans Go to the Movies.
Yeah, wow. Which is a real movie that was really good that nobody saw.
It's so good.
It's great.
The best way to watch Space Jam.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, but I was the joke though is that I asked them, I was like, oh, obviously this movie is going to make a lot of money. We will definitely see sequels, I'm sure. I want to see a meta movie where Mario and Luigi go to the movies. And then Michael, the director, he said, oh yeah, Mario and Luigi go down Crime Alley. Which, if you haven't seen Teen Titans Go to the Movies, Crime Alley is referenced as Bruce Wayne's parents getting killed.
Yeah.
And in the Teen Titans movie, which is a kid's movie, in the movie, Robin has to go back in time because he doesn't want Batman to exist. So he pulls his parents out of Crime Alley and saves them. Then at the end of the movie, they realize they do need Batman. So Robin pushes his parents into Crime Alley and there's a bunch of gunshots. Oh, Red, look at that. It is horrifying. Yeah. Whoa. Very. Wow. Well done. Well done on that footage. Wow. Yes. And that is canon to the Mario movie, is Mario and Luigi will go down Crime Alley.
Die?
Well,
no, their parents will die.
Whoa, no spoilers, Reb.
What's happening right now? How is it relevant to the Nintendo Entertainment System?
Reb, I have something for the Nintendo Entertainment System, actually. And this reminds me of something in Spider-Man No Way Home.
This is exactly why I silenced Jeffrey in our morning meetings.
No.
he goes from point eight, one day, he goes from world 1-1 to world 5-3 and then back to 6-2 just to get to 1-2. Like, he just cannot.
I appreciate you trying to bring it back to Mario with those references, but I'm going to let me just hear me out on this.
We'll hear you out.
Spider-Man Far From Home. Mm-hmm. In that movie, Nick Fury, played by Samuel Jackson, talks to Spider-Man, and he says, He says a Star Wars quote in it. He's just like, isn't that one of your favorite movies something? But it's like Nick Fury, Samuel Jackson, he's in Star Wars as Mace Windu. So that is kind of the same thing with the Mario. Yeah, exactly. Wow, Red, you were like exactly knowing the exact timestamp I'm talking about. Yeah, Nick Fury is like, yeah, he says a quote from Star Wars. So it's like, okay, is this the same thing where Mario sees Mario in the like world of Mario, but it's not him? Mm-hmm. Like, it's just, it's not, you know, it's just like when, you know, there's a lot of different characters that share universes, like in Marvel, Star Wars.
But at what point does he start getting suspicious? Because, like, look, the Mario movie is not, like, literally one-to-one the plot of the original Super Mario Brothers or anything like that. But as the Mario movie, as the Mario games start coming out in that universe, like, at one point does he start going, hey, this is remarkably like personal experiences I have been having. What is going on?
That's why at the end of all the movies he goes to see in the theaters, it has at the very bottom line of the credits is like this, any, you know, replication of people, fictional or real.
Yeah.
It doesn't like it's
I think
it's purely made
at
up.
At a certain point, though, like I'm thinking of a couple very specific lines that characters say to him.
Well,
it's like.
Like Wahoo.
Yeah, like that.
Spoilers.
Wahoo. Wahoo. There's line in the Mario movie.
I can't. Also, the idea that Miyamoto is not like he is in the movie because there, again, no spoilers, but there are references to other. I mean, this is kind of hard to spoil because he has made so many wonderful games, but like there are other Miyamoto games in the movie that he definitely is not. He's doing more than finance, is all I'm saying.
Yes, though, for sure.
it presents a paradox, is all I'm saying.
There it is.
So, we've got to do it. We've got to do it.
What?
Mario movie one, Sonic movie one, which takes the crown.
Okay.
Oh, that's hard because the Sonic
It's not hard. You just
it's
say
not hard. You just gotta pick a side, Jeffrey. Pick a side.
Pick a side.
I want you to go first because I know you're a big Sonic fan.
I do love Mario and Sonic at the Olympic Games.
Winter edition.
Sonic movie isn't fully animated, so it's hard to.
But it's still a movie about a video.
What? I would
it's actually a documentary.
Regardless of animation or real,
I'll save Jeffrey.
You know, blend.
I think qualitatively, Sonic is a better movie.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. I still want to hear Jeffrey say. I want Jeffrey to answer.
I think also Sonic is the better movie in terms of like story and like kind of like rewatchability. The Mario movie is just like a music video, a history of, which is fun. Like I like both of them in different ways, but yeah, probably Sonic. The first Sonic movie has like it's like, you know, it's kind of an origin story in a way as well for Sonic and Mario. So it's like, I'm going to exit out Discord and leave the chat because I don't think I can continue this conversation.
Yes.
I love Mario and Sonic too much.
I got Jeffrey off of NVC. I broke
him. Hey, Jeffrey, Sonic movie was better is a complete sentence. You can just say that.
Yeah.
All right. Can we, I'll move my mouth and then can you say that for me, Reb?
Yeah, sure. All right. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Sonic movie was better.
All right, great. I can't be canceled that way, so we're good.
Cool.
How about you,
Seth? You could just be like, that was a deep fake. Confession, I've never seen the Sonic movie.
I
think Mario movies.
You should fix that, dude. You should. Good.
They're great.
It's fun.
Ben Schwartz is a wonderful. And remember
I know. Everybody in my family's seen them. They like them a lot, and I just never got around to it. You know,
wait, so Seth, were you confused when Sonic appeared in the post-credit scene at the end and he said, we are here to join the Smash Brothers initiative?
Yeah, that was crazy.
I mean, it was announced by Nick Fury there. He was there, so it was just a really weird time.
Nick Fury is confirmed for Smash, actually. We thought Sakurai was done. Well, you're wrong, because now it's a Marvel.
Wait a minute, Nick Fury's in Star Wars.
we need to get to our next segment, which is now that, of course, Super Mario is going to be the second highest grossing animated movie of all time. It doesn't matter. This movie's going to make a ton of money.
Yep.
Stupid amounts of money. I think it made $26 million yesterday, and it wasn't even open. It just people just threw money. When they drove by the theater, they threw just bundles.
Coins. Coins and stuff.
Just coins. You know, it was appropriate. I like that thematically. But we're going to pitch other Nintendo movies. These are serious pitches. In fact, you can go check out our NVC column this week where I think is that Jada, you did one. Pear mm-hmm. does one. Reb, you did one. Jeffrey, I don't know.
Oh, that got published? I was just writing for fun.
No, it's going
fun.
To be. Yeah. Brendan Graber pitched one. And I also pitched one. And I got a little bit too deep into it. And I had to stop because it was going to be turning into fanfic.net kind of stuff. So, Reb, let's hear your idea.
My pitch is super simple and uncomplicated. It does not require a lot of extra stuff. I just think they should turn Luigi's Mansion into a movie. We could bring back all of the same voice cast, do the Illumination thing again. Charlie Day was phenomenal. He'd be a great Luigi for Luigi's Mansion. The plot of Luigi's Mansion is just fine. Get someone really goofy and weird to be EGAD and, you know, make Luigi's Mansion. I think you would need a little more of a plot. You would need to flesh out probably some of the ghosts a little bit more. You could maybe borrow some ghosts from the other Luigi's Mansion, like maybe borrow some stuff from Dark Moon or whatever.
Talk to some portraits, to some sculptures.
Yeah, have like some other things going on so that it's like a little more fleshed out. I think you want to bring in what's his name, the really cute little goat, Polterpup. Bring in Polterpup. Mm-hmm. Polterpup doesn't show up till Dark Moon, but I think you could bring him in Luigi's Mansion easily as like initially a character that scares Luigi but then is, you know, becomes a friend and companion. I also think bringing in Gooigi at this stage would be an excellent choice.
Yep.
But yeah, like you really, you got 90 minutes of movie right there. Luigi's Mansion, easy.
Charlie
did. Ghostbuster style, not scary at all, just fun, like released on Halloween.
I would pay to see a movie of Charlie Day just doing like improv for 90 minutes.
Yeah,
like,
getting freaked out by ghosts.
Like that would be great. I would I'd pay
Mario.
Charlie Day is Luigi. Charlie Day is Luigi and Danny DeVito as EGAD.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Always Sunny.
This is bringing it Always Sunny in Luigi's Mansion.
Yeah.
Yes.
That might be good, yeah.
I'm into that. All right. Luigi's Mansion. Jada.
Okay. I'm going off of memory here because I haven't looked at it since I wrote it on like Monday, but here we go. Gritty reboot of Zelda Noir. So we're taking Link as a detective, and it's, you know, it could be all black and white. We could do some color if you want to. But we're doing, you know, Link is this like hardened veteran detective, and the Triforce has been stolen, and he's got to go around town investigating. He's got to go investigate all of Hyrule to find out who stole the Triforce. Now you may be wondering, but Link doesn't talk. How is he an investigator? Well, you know what? I got that. He's got internal monologues for the fans watching the movie, so it's not actually Link's voice, but just how he hears himself. So,
oh my God,
canon, but not
voicing
canon.
This.
Let's do
Charlie Day.
Yeah, Charlie Day. Charlie Day's just gonna rule Nintendo.
Princess Zelda.
Link is joined by his long-term partner Z, and who is the daughter of the chief of the Hyrule Police. And so, you know, she does all the interrogation and talking. They do a kind of good cop, bad cop kind of thing when they're interrogating people for investigations and stuff. And they've got to go through all, you know, different regions. And the conspiracy goes deeper than you think when looking for the different pieces of Triforce, because they've learned at the end of the first one that it's been split into three parts. And the conspiracy goes deeper. Are the Gerudo involved? How about the Zoros? The Zoras? The Gorons? Could be anybody. Maybe the Ritos. Never really trusted them birds. But there's plenty of movies there. So, Zelda Noir.
This is way more creepy. I was just like, Luigi's Mansion movie, here you go. And you made up a whole thing that...
I like to write short stories. So, like...
Fun, yeah.
And there's way more going to be in my column than I mentioned there. That's all I remember.
I want to watch more detective things. So...
We got Detective Pikachu. Let's do Zelda Noir.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
I'm
yeah.
With that.
With Danny DeVito as Pikachu.
Yeah. It's perfect.
I love the idea of like I'm imagining the Gorons being interrogated and he's just like eating a giant rock. like in the dark, like just can't see him yet. Oh, the Goron is doing the dining in the dark.
There you go.
That's a callback right there.
All comes back around. I didn't actually contribute to the NVC columns for movies because I'm actually in current negotiations with Universal Illumination and Nintendo to make this happen.
Okay.
Which is a huge conflict of interest for my job.
That's fine. Nobody pays attention.
It's fine. Yeah. No one. Yeah. Universal isn't listening to this. I would love to see an Animal Crossing movie. Now, hear me out.
Oh, yeah.
I love a good slice of life movie. And what's more slice of life than the Animal Crossing the railroad, the game. It is very, I don't know why I said that. We'll cut that out.
Fix it in post, folks.
It's so fun because like every kind of slice of life is like, it's a coming of age, right? It's like, you know, you're moving maybe away from the city folk, and you're settling down. You're starting over. You have literally hundreds of characters to choose from. And there's your Easter eggs right there. Just like, oh, I wonder if my favorite, you know, animal neighbor is going to be in the movie. And I would just let, you could do anything. I mean, what's the origin of Tom Nook? Why is he at this island? Why is Blathers, you know, Blathers obviously voiced by Danny DeVito. Like
we here at NVC only know the names of three actors: Jack Black, Charlie Day, and Danny DeVito.
Yeah, Charlie Day. Yeah, but I really, you know, maybe the movie does so well that it gets a spinoff into a TV series, and maybe every episode is a different hour of the game, so it's a different music kind of. Oh, maybe it's just like 24 with Jack Bauer, and so Animal Crossing, the show takes place in real time. Mm. Ooh, man, maybe I should stop talking because I do want to actually. I am going to make this.
If you say trademark, then it's trademark.
Trademark. Okay.
I feel like Animal Crossing has a lot of potential.
Jeffrey, let's just start a YouTube channel and we'll just live stream Animal Crossing Machinima like 24/7.
Yeah. Let's get a voice cast.
That's a super good idea.
Wait, we actually should do that.
Has a lot of potential as like a Ghibli style kind of thing.
Oh, I agree.
Like a little slice of life, like kids out in the summer playing.
They could also like take a bunch of characters. Yeah, they could also take all the characters and do all the movies based on things that are entering public domain. So we could get a Winnie the Pooh movie set in Animal Crossing.
Oh, yeah.
We could get Mickey Mouse when he enters public domain in the near future.
That's true.
Wait.
They'll change the constitution.
Reb, you, I'm tearing up thinking about my neighbor Tortimer.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Did you actually,
nobody take this idea?
Jeffrey, did you see there was like an animated Animal Crossing short or something that was
there
done?
There is an anime, I believe.
I watched it ages ago. I don't remember what the context was, but.
Yeah, I think it was like a promo for something, but there is like an animated, maybe it's like a shorter series.
It's something,
that I've seen clips of.
It's nice.
Yeah, it is. It's got, oh man, the Studio Ghibli, like I'm just thinking of like all the food. I mean, there's like thousands of items. Like,
oh, wow.
Oh man, and also like so colorful, so vibrant.
Yeah.
Maybe I want to see the Animal Crossing movie in 2D. I mean, let's bring 2D animation back.
It's funny that you should both mention Studio Ghibli.
Oh boy.
My pitch for a movie is based on the world, a little game called The Breath of the Wild.
Mm-hmm.
However, it is not about Link. It is not about Zelda. It is about one of the many people who just lives in that world, and it's going to be animated. It's not going to be CG. It's going to be like either a Studio Ghibli or like, I don't know if you've seen the movie The Secret of Kells, which is a highly stylized sort of animation style. It's very beautiful. This would be a non-playable character, which takes a lot of the pressure away from trying to figure out who Link is, because as we know, Link is basically the stand-in for you. Link doesn't talk. Link just goes around. And so you get to sort of make your own idea. Link doesn't have much of a backstory. He wakes up and then there's something that he has to go do, which, to be fair, it's kind of how life is. You wake up and you have to go do something. So serves two interests at the same time. It creates new and interesting characters, their own motivations that are more closely identifiable by an audience, but it also sets it in a familiar and vast world, because honestly, in Breath of the Wild, while you play as Link, I feel personally that Hyrule is the main character of Breath of the Wild, and Link's role in that is to just tease out details about this character, and so we could cast it, and it just opens the door for any kind of movie you want. Breath of the Wild, animated by Studio Ghibli, look for that 2028. And also look for me in my new Bentley, because that's the first thing I'm going to buy. One of those limo ones that has a recliner you can sleep inside of, not while you drive. So there it is.
It's got a mini fridge too, probably, right?
It does have a mini fridge, but it's only got the hoppinest champagne that I don't drink. So it's actually sparkling cider, which they can't sell in Maine anymore because it doesn't fit some definition of what cider is. So basically what I'm saying is my Bentley has nothing to drink in it.
Some real world problems you got there, Seth.
Yeah.
I can't wait. Absolutely. I can't wait to make my own Bentley in Tears of the Kingdom.
Oh man.
Yeah.
Well, that's another thing. You're gonna go cook something and you got that Studio Ghibli food and it's bouncing mm-hmm. around and it's so good looking, and I bet you can even smell it. In fact, it's gonna be the first animated movie to integrate smell-o-vision.
No.
No, it's gonna smell like grasslands. And fields.
No.
You get to a lion-o, you're like,
it's gonna trigger a whole bunch of sneezing fits from people with allergies.
Well, it's gonna be hypoallergenic grass.
They do that at Disneyland. They have Soarin' Over California. It's like they're famous for that grass smell. That fresh cut grass smell when you fly over California. Yeah,
Jeffrey keeps a baggie of like blades of grass in a Ziploc baggie for when he flies. So when he flies,
Reb, have
over
you
California,
not been to
heat.
Disney World and or Disney California Adventure?
Not since I was six.
Oh, everyone in the comments, let's get together. We're gonna get Reb to
send
Disneyland.
Send in one coin. And you can help send Reb to...
We're going
to
do a coin starter so that Reb can smell the grass at Soarin' Over California.
What?
This is not anything I was aware of either.
I grew up in Kansas where people mow their lawns every day. I mean, right. It's...
It kind of smells like that.
Sorghum.
I know what it... It's fine.
Don't you want to spend $400 to go
smell
that?
Grass? No, thank you.
Smell cut grass.
I'm in California. There's plenty of that going on.
Whoa, Reb. Reb, now you're canceled.
Sorry.
No, it's fine.
Is she canceled
it's
for that, sir? You can't cancel
right.
her for that. It's
you're
California.
You're right.
You're
right.
Canceled.
California. No, that's you're right. It's very it's legal here. That's totally fine. It's fine. We're all in California, especially Seth Macy.
Yep.
Yeah.
100%
honorary Californian.
It's legal here too. And
he's fine.
If there was ever any doubt, just walk along the side of the road and you see all the pre-roll plastic containers that people throw out because they just have a pre-roll before they go to work in their car and they just throw them outside of the road.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Don't do that.
Doing that.
Yeah, littering is bad.
Littering is very bad.
Yeah.
It is.
Look, I'll go on a whole tangent about how 90% of the litter
unless
I
you're in Mario Kart, then
the
littering
dispensaries
is okay.
in Maine. And people just maybe should stop doing that, or else like people who don't like litter are gonna be like, maybe we should stop using
all the other questionable behavior we've suggested on the show, whatever. But like seriously,
don't litter.
Yeah. Don't litter. Yeah.
Like
it is illegal.
Don't do that.
Like, yeah.
Banana
yeah.
peels Wait, are the only thing legal and only if you're playing Mario Kart.
True.
Yeah. Can I say something just to the people listening? Like none of you can listen to this.
Okay.
Littering is fun. Like throw stuff out of your car. It's
no, Seth.
Gosh, darn it. Why?
All right. Okay. So Reb,
I stopped listening. Ears, so the little earpiece in my ear wouldn't. Wait. What?
Yeah. All right. We're gonna have to do a coup.
I gotta get this back on track. No, we have a. We have
Seth
a.
Needs to drive the podcast.
We have a question. Actually, I'm kind of jumping ahead because this is a kind of a complicated question. So it's not question blocked. It was a question sent in by a listener by the name of Casey Crossen, or Croson. I'm sorry, Casey. Hi, Super Nintendos. Over the weekend, I was saddened to discover that the storage area where I live had been broken into, and while nothing was taken that's irreplaceable, a number of game consoles I've had since childhood,
SNES,
etc., are now gone. For
that's
whatever reason,
awful.
All the games for said consoles remain, so I wanted to ask the panel's thoughts on how best to build back from this. Would you recommend getting replacements of the original consoles, something that's more contemporary, like a Retron 5 or analog, or a scaler like a Retro Tink line recommended by the Facebook group, which I'm an active member of, to use original consoles on modern displays? Thanks for your thoughts, the show, and overall work in journalism. That is specifically aimed at Reb, who, by the way, senior news reporter Reb Valentine.
Shucks.
What's up?
Oh yeah,
let's do that. Let's,
we're gonna take you to Disneyland.
Don't do this.
Okay. Well, then I won't compliment you anymore. But let's answer this question. And your sweater is great, by the way.
Oh my god,
I've been wanting to talk about that.
The sweater is actually quite good.
It's amazing.
It's really comfortable.
It's like your favorite Afghan at your Grammy's house.
It's really
like you could
nice.
Wear it. It just looks so comfy.
Yeah.
Anyway,
it's got big floppy sleeves.
What do you all think? What is your recommendation to build back?
Yeah, I don't, I'm not like, this feels like a Seth Macy question deeply, so I want to hear Seth's answer, but I generally hear good things about the analog pocket. My partner has one every time he pops a little Game Boy or Game Boy Color, Game Boy whatever game in there. It looks really good.
It's super good.
I feel like with the market being the way it is now, and with consoles getting older and older, you're probably going to have better luck getting some modern things that can play multiple kinds of games so that they don't like immediately fall apart on you and are guaranteed to run for a long time, as opposed to trying to find, you know, something that is clean and functional and affordable and also extremely old. But Seth might have a better answer than that.
Well, it just so happens that I don't know if I have a better answer, but I have answers. And I would say that you kind of lucked out, Casey, because they took the consoles, and the consoles are actually the easiest and cheapest thing to replace. Oh, some of those games
I don't know anything
are
then, yeah.
Really hard to replace in any way that you would consider affordable. In fact, yeah, one of your best things, if you want to go the console route, is go on eBay and find or Facebook Marketplace and find an NES that says not working or four parts. And then go watch my new show, This Old Tech, on IGN's YouTube, and follow This
That's
Old
what
Tech
this is.
On Instagram. What? No, it's not.
Seth sent this question in himself.
He did.
I'm kidding.
No, but seriously, you should definitely follow This Old Tech on Instagram. But no, my actual answer is
the consoles are.
The consoles are they're getting more expensive now, but they're easier to replace than the games. However, that being said, a Retron 5 is pretty awesome because you can play a lot of different types of games on one thing, and it goes look at that. Look at me. There's me showing you how to fix your NES. You can watch the next show that I'm recording later on.
What episode do you tell people to just blow on the cartridges?
This is the one where I said, don't do that, because it doesn't actually do anything.
It doesn't.
No, it doesn't. It's a coincidence if it works. Where was I? Oh yeah, Retron 5 is awesome. I really liked my Retron 5. I had it for a long time. And you can use that on modern TVs, and you can do other things like you get Famicom or Super Famicom games, and you can actually load translation patches in on an SD card. So you can buy Japanese versions of Super Metroid or Final Fantasy VI, which are, by the way, way cheaper, have better art, and come complete from Japan on eBay. And then you can play them with English translations. Some of the translations that people have out there are better than the official translation. The analog systems are amazing. They're FPGA, which is a whole different thing. They have the best possible emulation, but they're kind of expensive and they're kind of hard to come by. They don't make a lot of them. And then the RetroTik, I don't have any experience with that, but I know that there's the Mr. FPGA, which also expensive, hard to get right now, but is the best emulation machine because it's not actually emulation. It is hardware on an FPGA, which means that it's actually whatever. It's a whole thing. What I'm trying to say is you're going to be fine. I'm glad they didn't take your games. It sucks that those are your consoles from when you're a kid, though. That's a huge problem, because I have all my consoles that I owned as a kid, but they're not the actual. So Jeffrey, Jada, do either one of you have any recommendations for Casey?
I'd say become your own vigilante and hunt the person down, and take vengeance into your own hands. This is your superhero origin story, so embrace it.
Better than getting pushed into Crime Alley.
Yes, much better than getting pushed into Crime Alley.
That's a good Nintendo movie, is Casey going and getting back the systems that are rightfully hers.
Yep.
My suggestion is very boring and expensive, but in Los Angeles, we have a lot of great local game shops, a lot of consoles come in all the time. I always love going just to see what's new, and just recently, I saw the Hey You Pikachu N64, blue and yellow.
Yeah,
it was $100, which is a lot of money, but not that much considering it's a special edition console for a thing from 30 years ago.
$250 new. I remember.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah. Oh, is it? Oh, I should go back and buy that. Sorry, Casey. Do not go to the game shops. I'm gonna buy it instead. It's obviously more expensive to buy it like that, but usually the local kind of indie game shops are run by really cool people, and support your local, don't go to the big box retailers. Obviously they're gonna be marked up because they're brick and mortar stores, but it is always fun to kind of go and see. Like, you could slowly build up your collection that way. Like, oh, like there's a Game Boy Advance for like $70 and like, yeah, I'll just have that now.
You can also check out like conventions and stuff. Sometimes they have little small things like that at good conventions call. And that's a good way to also pick. So there's some real advice from you other than becoming your own Nintendo superhero.
I mean, I think both of those are good at pieces of
advice. I agree.
I'm a vigilante. And then
go to conventions.
I will say like PAX, I'm always surprised. There's generally speaking at PAX East, there are several dealers that they come up from like New York City or they're just like local to Boston or Massachusetts. And you would think that they would gouge, but the prices that they have there pretty much in line with what you can buy those games like online or like through an eBay auction. And plus, it's awesome to just be like, I would like to buy Mega Man X, please. And they're like, here you go.
Yeah, you know, I mean, and you get to like inspect it right in person versus buying it online at a store where it's like, is this actually the picture?
Yeah.
And they always have stacks of consoles and they've done all the testing. They're not going to try to rip you off. So yeah, good advice, everyone. I appreciate that. But the best advice, obviously, was to go to this_old_tech on Instagram. Give that a follow. We do content all the time on that. And whenever the new show comes out, first, no. Hey, guess what? It's the time for the Miiverse. Reb, what's this Dredge game you've been playing?
Oh, Seth, I'm so excited to tell you about this.
Tell us about Dredge.
Dredge is a little game I've been playing lately that is a game about fishing. It's a fishing game.
I love fishing so much.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Not enough games with fishing.
You play as this fellow who has been hired to be the new fisherman for this little village.
Yes.
Because they need fish to stay alive. And you go out during the day and you fish and you bring the fish back and you sell them. And you take the money and you use it to upgrade your boat and get better parts that will make you better at fishing. You will go faster. You will be able to catch more kinds of fish. All these other different things. The fishing is this neat little mini game where it's a little bit passive. You'll fish automatically over time, and the clock ticks. The clock ticks down if you're moving or if you're actively fishing. But you can make yourself fish faster by doing like time button presses. And there's a bunch of different variations on that. There's one where it's like a wheel slowly turning out. There's one where it's like, okay, hit it when it's within the green boundaries. There's like a bunch of different variations on it.
It's like a rhythm game, kind of.
A little bit. It's not really. It's not like musically rhythmic.
It's more like like mini games.
Yeah, it's a bit WarioWare-esque, I guess, in that sense. But there's different variations on it. You catch the fish, you bring them in, you sell them. While all this is going on, you're warned, maybe make sure you come in before sundown. And, you know, you probably start by doing that. And
all the good fish come out at night.
Oh, yeah. And then suddenly you have to
go fishing.
That's a song.
That's right. Like the fish come out at night.
Yeah.
Right? That's the song.
And then you go out at night to catch the fish you need.
There's
like little quests. there's a little quest, you know, go catch me this, go do this. And then things start getting weird at night. There's eyes looking back at you in the dark, and there's strange things swimming in the deep. And sometimes you fish up a fish that doesn't look quite right. Looks a little weird. Maybe it's got two heads. And maybe things chase you at night and cause problems, maybe even damage your boat. Maybe there's a rock in the water that you didn't really think was there.
That's a real thing.
Oh, wow.
Rocks in water.
And things, and then you start fishing up, you start learning how to dredge and you start fishing up items that are a little spooky. And there's a fellow who wants you to collect more spooky items for him. And that's Dredge is going out and trying to sort of figure out what is going on in this strange ocean that gets real weird at night and produces real weird fish while also, you know, surviving.
So, so fisherman by day, paranormal hunter by night.
Kind of. Yeah.
You had me at like a fishing, you're like, oh, it's a fishing game. Well, I gotta go download this now, I guess.
Yeah, it has this.
And you're like, there's spooky stuff. Like, what? How does this keep getting better?
It has this mechanic. I'm really glad I do not think they use this language. So, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but I've not seen this language yet. I'm glad they don't use like sanity meter because I think that's a little bit this terminology I don't super
like
care
in
for.
In that old Call of Cthulhu game.
Yeah, I don't love that terminology. Xbox. But when you are out at night and seeing these weird things, you do start to get a little bit freaked out. naturally because things are weird out there. And the more freaked out you are, the more weird things you start to see. And so you're constantly playing this game of how long can I, you know, I need to accomplish this goal that I can only accomplish at night.
I like that.
How long do I stay out? And it's not, it's not just seeing weird things. It's the things that actually can harm you. Like, I mean, if you're watching the video, you just saw a tentacle come cream this guy's boat into smithereens.
Rest in peace.
So you're trying to balance out, you know, how long can I stay out, accomplish what I need to do without causing deep harm to my boat.
I have a very serious question, and it will determine if I can, if I buy this game or not.
Okay.
Can I name my boat?
No.
No. That's it. That's it for me. Sorry, guys.
Well,
sorry,
I hope the developer is listening. If you want that Jada money, you got to add.
I need to be able to name my boat. I mean, how else is Bodie McBoatface going to make?
They're going to issue a patch like immediately, like an out of cycle patch.
Yeah. No, you can't name the boat.
This game. You just sold me like 5 times.
Yeah.
It does look very good.
It seems short. I'm not done with it yet, but I feel like I'm like roughly halfway through and I've played about 4 or 5 hours. So I'm thinking it's probably going to cap out at about 10. There's like side quests. There's kind of a main quest that you're doing. There's roughly 5 main areas in this ocean. And I have now visited, 5. I have now visited 3 of them, starting to go to the 4th. It's quite good. It's on most of the platforms. It's on Switch.
Nice. What was the little eyeball at the top during the day?
I think that was the fear.
Yeah,
like,
that's the indicator of how weird, how freaky things are getting. During the daylight, if you have not encountered anything weird, it stays closed. But then as you start encountering more and more weird things, the eye opens. It starts blue, and then like it changes color. So it goes like blue, green, brown, I think red. I don't know if there's a color beyond that, but it's sort of an indicator.
Colors.
You have to calm down. You can calm down a little bit by being in light. So either during daylight or like by standing next to a light or by sleeping. Sleeping is
that
how you calm down.
I shouldn't sleep on my boat.
For me.
You can sleep on your boat, but you have to be in a port.
It's called a rack on a boat, actually. That's the Marines. What they call it.
Seth.
Never mind. What?
He tried to tie it back in and make it wholesome.
I'm leaving.
Jada cannot sleep on an unnamed boat, Seth.
That's true.
I can't.
That's true.
I can't.
Sorry. That is
it's bad juju.
It is bad luck to change the name of a boat. That's what
whole like subplot in Dredge that where you're finding like these notes about this guy who did a renaming ceremony on a boat and then got really paranoid that he did the renaming ceremony incorrectly, because you can rename a boat, but if you rename it incorrect, if you don't do the ceremony correctly, it messes things up. And because this is a world where there's like weird tentacle beasts popping out of the water all the time, this obviously resulted in, I presume, horrible misfortune for this person. It seems like it's going down a bad road. I guess we'll have to find out.
It sounds like I'm just making it up because I live in Maine, but I know a lot of fishermen and they're all a very superstitious lot. Mm-hmm. There are certain like fish that they're like, get that off the deck, it's bad news. And then also I watched Master and Commander. Have you seen that movie? Man, that's a good movie.
The sea is a cruel mistress.
Fish are weird. Have y'all ever looked at a fish before? Fish are so freaking weird. Like, they got these weird eyes and these weird shapes. Yeah. If you like look at a fish, if I've never seen a fish before and someone brought me a fish, like, hey, look at this, I'd be like, get that out of here. That doesn't belong here.
How does some of them even walk around?
That's a demon.
Some of them have human teeth.
That is messed up. Yeah, like the parrotfish. That's a weird messed up thing. All right, Dredge, I'm going to get this game. I want to talk real quick about something that I've been up to. I've been playing MLB The Show 23. That's a really good game. But on past episodes, I talked about my brother found an Apple Lisa at his local dump 5 years ago, which is a rare Apple computer that's worth like a few $1,000s in working condition. And he gave me the power supply to recap, which I did. No cap, kids. And he still couldn't get it to work, so I brought it home with me. And it's, I have to be a weatherman here. Find me.
Oh, there it is.
Right there.
And that's pretty cleaned up for being found at a dump.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to say, it looks brand new.
We've been... If you were close to it, you would smell the filth. That's not true. It does have that like 1980s electronic smell, which I love. Whoa.
Wow.
So This particular Appaloosa is not the one that's in the video right now. That is the most rarest and most valuable one. That is the original Appaloosa. That is the one that Steve Jobs stopped. He was working on that and then he just left it. As he's prone to do.
Seth, that's also a great suggestion for Casey. Maybe Casey can go to a dump and find all of her Nintendo consoles.
And then send it to Seth in a stinky box.
into a trash bag, like a wet paper bag that's just caked with filth. And I'll see what I can do. But it's funny because my brother has, so many consoles and computers and just like awesome stuff. I have an Apple IIe over here. I have a Game Gear over here that's all his that I'm going to be fixing for my new show, This Old Tech, on IGN. Oh, make sure you follow that on Instagram there. But I haven't been playing anything except for MLB The Show. That's a very fun game. I haven't been playing it on Nintendo Switch, so I can't speak to that. Jada, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. I've been playing a lot of games. The main one I'm playing right now, I can't talk about yet.
Put that on your bingo card. Yes. That's my favorite.
But I will be back to talk about it soon. So I'm very excited.
It's called Tears of the Kingdom.
It is called Tears of the Kingdom. outside of that, I'm playing a darling little indie that just dropped called Meet Your Maker. If you have not seen this game, it dropped on PS Plus, but it's basically Super Mario Maker meets Doom. And so you build these dungeons and then you go through other people's dungeons to try and steal their like materials and get out alive.
This looks rad.
At my first day playing it, I hated this game. I absolutely thought it was just, it didn't look what I expected from watching the trailers and stuff, because it looked a lot faster in the trailers. It's a lot, you can move through it quicker, but you'll probably die a lot more. So I'm moving through it a little bit slower. The thing that's really sparked my interest with it is the building mechanic and building my own dungeons and such for other people.
Yeah,
and then watching, and then you get to watch the replays. It records the replays of people going through your dungeon and dying a bunch of times. So like I had this one trap where there is a holographic box. So it's nothing actually there. It's a mirage. But behind it, there's a skewer trap. It makes it look like you can grapple to this box that's a mirage. So people grapple into the skewer and they get skewered and then they fall into an acid pit. And it's great. It is very mean, but it is a lot of fun. There's a lot of very creative people that are making very cool dungeons I've explored. I'm not going to, lie. I have been shot in the back by some arrows on the way leaving. Like, I've walked out of the dungeon. I'm like, I'm safe. And then an arrow hits me in the back of the head. So people are very, very, are much meaner than I am. But it's great. I really enjoy the building mechanics. So if you like Super Mario Maker, if you like Minecraft even, because it's all like, most of it's like kind of box-based
for
building stuff.
I like both of those things.
You'll probably really like it. The only thing is, like, you do have to go through a bunch of dungeons to get the resources in order to unlock stuff to put in your dungeon and make really cool things. But
that's kind of cool, actually.
But it's cool. So you have to go, you have to go through other people's dungeons and die to make your own death trap.
I love that.
Cool. But yeah,
this on Switch?
I don't believe it's on Switch. It is on PS Plus right now.
What? Keep that on Beyond. Beyond bullcrap.
I believe it's also out on Steam as well. So you can, if you've got a PC, which,
well,
Seth,
we don't have a PC podcast anymore.
Seth, I know you've got at least one PC in your house. So
At least one.
So you could probably go play it there.
All right. Wow. Well, this looks awesome, and I kind of wish it were on Switch because I want to play it. I only have a Switch, actually. I lied. I don't have a PC. I'm actually recording the show on my Switch.
through the IR camera on your Joy-Con.
There's so many good apps on the Switch.
It is true. Jeffrey, what have you been up to?
I just want to say really quick, Jade, I love you describing building dungeons and killing people while wearing Bowser horns. It's very poetic.
It's good,
I stay on point.
Every time it's just a camera shot of Jada talking with the horns, like, I'm off camera laughing because it's delightful.
It's really good.
It's just very
the best.
I love you're just like, it's very mean, but it's kind of fun. Like, you're Bowser.
Best character in the Mario movie, hands down.
Fantastic.
Oh yeah, so good. I am currently I'm trying to 100% Breath of the Wild right now.
Whoa.
I've been playing it for six.
How many Korok seeds do you have?
Okay.
The Korok seeds is just, that is not even, that I'm not even, that's not even on my roadmap right now. I'm,
so you're not going for the 100%.
I really, well, okay. Wow. Okay. Cool it with the Bowser horns here. I mostly just trying to get all the shrines. I realized there are just a couple shrines that I've missed that some of them are like part of the DLC kind of. So yeah. It's like, you know, I'm using our very wonderful IGN like interactive map on IGN.com to find some of the shrines I just cannot find, because it's just fun to just wander around and hope that the shrine indicator starts beeping. But then it's like some of them, you know, they're like shrine quests where you can, you know, it's like you have to talk to somebody to kind of trigger the kind of shrine reveal. But it's really fun. I can't remember what it's called in the game, but it's in the northern map of Hyrule where it's just a big forest where it's completely black. Like you go in,
yeah.
It's shrouded. And I forgot how scary that is. There's no way, like you have a torch obviously they can use, but I've been using like the Guardian shield and sword because it kind of glows and it kind of illuminates more. And I just like, I hate that my mind immediately was like, oh, I should make another dining, another.
I was going to say, you're going.
Dining in the dark. Yeah, dining in the dark. Because you can like sit at a stove and cook something. But it's just, I was playing that last night. I was like, wow, this is like, I took some screenshots. It is just pitch black. Like it is truly just the glow of like the Guardian sheath of my sword. And yeah, I'm worried, like, should I not play Breath of the Wild so much right before Tears of the Kingdom? Because it's just going to feel like the same game, which is
no.
Good. The game is good. But I'm just getting really excited because I feel like the game Tears of the Kingdom will feel so different from Breath of the Wild, even though it looks the same, that I'm just like getting so amped that I can't believe we're going to get Tears of the Kingdom in almost a month. Which
yeah, it's
crazy.
Like less than 5 weeks.
I feel like you're doing... I feel like you're going to have a satisfying experience with this, because I've talked on here before about how like I came back and did the Champions Ballad DLC. And then I realized at that time that I had not finished all the shrines. And so I kind of did what you did. Like I tried to get as many shrines as I could just by playing normally. Like I tried to visit areas of the map I knew I hadn't been to yet. I did all the quests. I kind of wandered around for a little bit. And then I did what you did and used a guide for like the last handful that I hadn't been able to find. And then I did Tarrytown because I had always really wanted to finish that quest. And then I felt satisfied. And I closed Breath of the Wild forever. And
whoa.
I
never to be opened again.
I don't think so. Like
no,
it's
done.
I dressed him up.
I'm coming to your house.
No.
I'm going to grab your Switch. I'm going to delete Breath of the Wild for you. You can keep your save file.
I can reinstall it.
Never to be opened again.
No, but I haven't opened it since then. Like I left it alone. It felt like I put Link in his green... the garb that you get for finishing all the shrines, his like original Link garb, and I stood him on a cliff overlooking Tarrytown at sunset, and I sat and looked at it for a minute, and I was like, yeah, this was a complete experience for me, and I put it away.
It's a nice way to kind of sunset it.
Yeah,
you know, to sunset that one.
I like games where I can do things like that.
Literally a sunset. I also forgot how much fun it is to dye your clothing. I was like, oh yeah, I forgot you can dye your clothing, because I made like a red tunic like when I first started playing, then never dyed anything again. And then now I have so many more clothes, and I'm going in there. I was like, oh, wait, you can like change clothing that you don't think you can change. Like I put on the armor, like just like very like, oh, he's going to be like, oh, you can't dye this. And then you can dye it. And it's fun.
It's an underrated feature. I enjoyed that a lot.
More games need armor dyeing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hope it comes back.
Like, armor dye simulator 2024.
That would actually probably do really well.
Yeah. There's like a whole genre of dress-up games.
Is there really?
Just late game for a lot of games, it's just like, you know, Monster Hunter, it's all about being the most fashionable hunter at the end of the game. So
yeah,
there's a market for
Animal
it.
Animal Crossing is a dress-up simulator for the most part.
Seth, there's a game series called Style Savvy that I've talked about before.
Oh, right.
That is basically just a dress-up game. And it's really genuinely very fun. And Sin Sophia, the developer, I do not remember the name of the new one, but they're making a new dress-up game for the Switch that was announced like in one of the last
directs. Yeah, because they was during that direct. And you're like, wait a minute.
Is that it Style like Savvy?
Yeah.
And then it was, is this the new one, isn't it?
Yes.
Oh, shoot, what's it called? I've got to wait for the video to tell me what it's called.
It's called
In
Dress
Style
Up and Get Up. in Murder Alley.
No, come on. Trailer. Oh, but they're really good. Like it's genuinely really good. I was really happy that since Sophia came back to do this, because it's like it's an underrated genre, and it's something that I feel like doesn't get a whole lot of like mainstream attention. But it's actually, I believe Style Savvy was one of the more popular franchises on the DS.
It definitely sold really well.
Yeah.
I sold a ton of copies to my GameStop days for that one.
Yeah. I don't know. Okay. Wow. Well, it'll tell me the title eventually.
This might be a surprise.
This is actually a 20-minute trailer.
So. Totally like unaware.
Yeah. It's like a...
it's I like this actually.
It's so funny. Red is like biting his tongue right now.
Fashion Dreamer.
Like, Fashion Dreamer. Available 2023. Wait a second. We're in 2020.
It's this year, everybody. Yeah.
It's almost here.
Who's on that review?
Sorry, Tears of the Kingdom.
Yeah, sorry, there's a new GOTY. It's Fashion Dreamer. Hey, I own more clothes than probably I should. So I'm into this idea of playing dress up virtually because it will take up a lot less closet space. Mm-hmm. We have
it's cheaper
limited,
too.
We find it's way cheaper. Well, here's the thing.
Uh-oh.
I live right next to TJ Maxx, so I'm always dressed in the best of last year's fashion.
The pinnacle of fashion.
Less. Yeah. People are like, where'd you get that shirt? And I'm like, I got it at TJ Maxx. Good luck. You'll never be able to get it again. And it was $12. By a brand you've never heard of. It smells a little bit like a warehouse fire for some reason.
It smells like my Apple
hey,
Lisa.
Seth, have you tried washing your clothes?
Have I tried washing your clothes? Is just wasteful, man.
It ruins them.
It just ruins them. That's how they come undone. And then the water, it washes that. You want to wash all of the filth into the ocean? Not me. I'll wear my filth and
he gets
something.
Seth doesn't believe about putting his filth on the ocean. He only believes in putting his filth on the street.
Put your filth in the trash can and don't litter.
Don't litter.
No, I agree. You should not litter.
100%. Yes.
If people are watching.
Seth.
Nobody's out. Country roads?
No.
Throw a tire out there. Throw a mag.
So many. About this.
So many caveats, Seth.
Yeah. I mean, like, if you live pretty much anywhere where there's country roads and you go down one, you're like, somebody just didn't want to throw away their washing machine, I guess, because there it is. Oh, look, there's a living room set.
Seth finds Apple TVs. Or
I wish.
Apple computers,
just whatever. Just set up just like a whole, like, desk's entertainment space just set up on this side of the road. He's like, oh. I'm gonna take this out
of baller, Casey, try driving down a country road.
Yeah.
See if you can find a Nintendo Entertainment System. Like,
well, I didn't find an NES, but I did find one tire. It's filled with mosquito
It'll just be an
larvae.
Animal. It's just an Animal Crossing journey then at that point.
Jada, thank you for joining us with your Bowser horns. Always a pleasure. We love having you on. It's so much better than that other podcast. I don't even remember what it's called, but you're with the PlayStation or whatever.
I don't get to wear horns on that one.
Yeah.
Eth.
See? Who's the winner? We're the winner. NVC. Yeah, we win. It's the only podcast where you can
get the thing.
Get the thing.
Everyone go listen to Jade on Beyond.
Yeah, listen to me there.
And go see the Mario movie.
Watch my Resident Evil clip.
That's a really good one, actually.